So good evening to all the participants today. I welcome you on behalf of the Madras Tax Bar. Before AP Srinivas sir takes over for giving the official welcome, I just have a couple of announcements to make. So Arvind Dattar sir will be taking through the session. All of you will be kept under mute, and the chat will also be disabled so that there's no disturbances in between. I also request all the participants to kindly turn off your camera so that we don't face any bandwidth problems. I thank you all once again for joining us this evening. Over to you, APS sir.
Privilege and honor to welcome Senior Advocate Mr. Arvind Dattar to Madras Tax Bar. Mr. Dattar sir needs no introduction and he is known to all. Anyhow, briefly I will tell about him. There are many interviews available about him in the on-site portals. So from that I was able to get one point where Mr. Dattar started his journey in the year 1990 with the Toyota Corona car. It was said, this was said about by him only, and now 40 years have gone. From the start of Central Excise Practice, he touched company law and raised as a constitutional lawyer. And he introduced Palkiwala to us. He popularized in South India and is one of the trustees in Palkiwala Foundation. And he has authored many books in Central Excise, Company Law, Constitution of India and Courtroom Genius. I was told that he is authoring one more book on income tax, Kanga and Palkiwala. He is revising. I think soon it will be published. And his arguments in case Puttaswamy case has taken him to a new thing by saying that he articulated the theory where the right to liberty, right to privacy is also can be considered as right to liberty, and it was accepted by the Supreme Court, and now the right to privacy is also considered as one of the right to liberty within Article 21, and his arguments with regard to Article 14 was also upheld by the Supreme Court. So now we have a constitutional expert, Mr. Arvind Dattar. Once again, I welcome him on behalf of the Madras Tax Bar. And today he is going to speak about his success and setbacks in his 40 years of legal journey, and it will be useful to all of us. I welcome Mr. Dattar, sir. Please.
Good evening to all of you. Good evening, all my dear friends of the Madras Tax Bar. It is thanks to COVID, I have been locked down in Chennai from 8 March, and I've been thoroughly enjoying my stay here. When I was asked to speak at the Madras Tax Bar webinar, Jay Kumar told me that they've been arranging almost, I think it's almost every day or every second day there's been a webinar. And this, I think, is the 52nd one and supposed to be the last in the continuous series. So when we were thinking about the topic, we thought that instead of speaking about law, one more topic, it was suggested that I can speak on some suggestions or some motivation for the younger generation. And I thought that why not I just look back on my 40-year journey, because I joined the bar in 1980, February. Actually, we should have started in 79, June, July, but because of continuous strikes, finally our results came only in February 80. So 1980 to 2020, 40 years have passed since I entered the Madras High Court. So I thought that whatever has happened in the past, there have been successes, there have been setbacks and other things I learned, I thought I'll share with you. And I also thought that I will share with you some aspects of topics that are dear to me, which I think will help all of you, at least the younger generation, to in their practice, in their personal lives and so on. First of all, let me congratulate the Madras Tax Bar for organizing these webinars. Frankly, till March 2020, I did not know what was a webinar. I had never watched a webinar. And now, over the last 8 weeks, the webinar has become part of our daily life. Words like Zoom, WebEx, Microsoft Teams, Google Hangouts have all become part of our daily vocabulary. While COVID-19 has definitely adversely affected large sections of our economy, affected our daily lives, particularly lives of the weaker sections, It has had one advantage that we have realized the power of digital technology. And now we are able to have hearings in court. We are able to have conferences, consultations with counsel, with instructing lawyers and so on the web. And I think in the days to come, we may not have to keep traveling so much. Traveling is definitely going to be reduced. So every setback has one silver lining. And when I was looking back at my own life, I found that almost every success was after a setback. So it's just a cycle of successes and setbacks. Nobody has only successes and nobody has only setbacks. So when I finally told Jaikumar I'll speak on this topic, then we finally arrived at this topic, successes and setbacks, lessons from a 40-year journey. Well, it is always embarrassing to speak about myself. I'll keep that to the barest minimum. I must also tell you that I'm not going to speak for 90 minutes. Speaking for 90 minutes nonstop is actually a violation of human rights of the listeners. So I'm going to be as brief as possible, maybe 30, 40 minutes, and I'll conclude. Now, looking back from 1980 to 2020, one thing which is really striking is the amazing change in the way we conduct our practice. When I joined the bar, there was no concept of a computer. There was no, question of any kind of mobile phone or technology, WhatsApp, all these are absolutely unheard of. And today it's difficult to imagine how we conducted our practice without these things. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Thanks. So one thing I learned is that the life of a lawyer is never really easy. A briefless lawyer is part of our English lexicon. And while I'm speaking, I've made some small notes to you. I've also prepared some slides so that I can convey what I want to say in very clear terms. And those who want to have this program later can use some of the lessons I've learned over the last 40 years. I must first begin before my practice in 1976 when I joined the Madras Law College. I came from Bombay and I joined the Madras Law College. Those of my young friends, many of whom are not born today, it was the last year of the emergency. The emergency started in 75, the emergency, and ended in 77. Of course, it was a case where there was a gross violation of human liberties, human rights, and so on. But the plus point was that in the first year of my law college, the colleges went absolutely on schedule. We started on time, there was no strike. We had the most amazing lecturers in law college. I still remember contracts being taught by Sri G.S. Thambi. The property law was taught by Justice Venkatachalamurthy. Kuppuswamy taught us evidence. And till today, I can remember the lectures of Justice Murthy, who taught me various topics on the law of property. 1977, the second year of my law college, was the year when Mrs. Gandhi lost the elections and the Janata Party came to power. Once again, we had democratic rights, we had freedom. We could go anywhere. We did not have any press censorship. But the minus point was that we again, law college started going on strike. You see, and classes were not being held. We would have several days on which come to college in the morning, saw some pretext or the other, there would be some strike. I remember in one case, the deputy foreign minister of Vietnam came and the whole college went on strike just to go and receive him at the airport. It was absolutely bizarre. I don't know what the Vietnamese foreign minister had to do because they had just won the war, Vietnam War. So it was a big euphoric time at that point of time. But again, that was a setback as far as the college is concerned. But the successful part was I was able to go to court because there's no college. I'd come to court in college in the morning. There's a strike, so what to do? And I just crossed the gate and go into the Madras High Court. Of course, it was a much smaller place. We didn't have several of these buildings. Of course, there was no question of any security and a pass and all that. So I would attend court. And the advantage of that was I was able to see very many senior lawyers in practice. And that was a phenomenal learning experience. I still remember very, very vividly listening to CY for half a day before court number two, the Canopy Court, where Justice Kothari now sits with Justice Ismail. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, the junior judge, I don't know, but Justice Ismail was the presiding judge. And then we had, from our bar, we had great giants. We had B.K.T. Chari, we had M.R. Narayan Swamy, we had V.P. Raman, Govind Swaminathan. Mr. K.K. Venugopal had almost shifted to Delhi by that time. And we had on the criminal side, my senior N. Natarajan and N.T. Vanamavalai. So all these people, I kept watching them in court and appearing. We also had the great privilege of listening to, apart from Siva, several lawyers from Delhi who came down at that point of time. We had Y.S. Chitale, we had Bridul, Ashok Sen, Ram Jethmalani, of course, and R.K. Garg. I remember listening to Fali Nariman in court 9 for Thiru Aroran Sugar. I still remember very clearly the arguments at that point of time. So, one lesson which you could learn is that for all of us is to watch the greats who are arguing. And I made it a point to listen to them, and I tried to observe what were the plus points, what were the minus points, mainly plus points, and what I could learn as a young lawyer. I still remember, I can still visualize Kesha Iyengar arguing a matter very, very methodically. And I first heard the word coram non judice hearing Mr. Kesha Iyengar arguing a matter before us. So the first lesson I would tell all of us is, all of you, is that keep observing people in court, learn from the seniors especially. And you also learn not only the plus point, but also the minus point. Even today when I'm in court, either in Delhi or in Madras or High Court, I'm sitting in court, I try to watch what others are doing. You know, how sometimes I find a young lawyer arguing so nicely. There's so much to learn from, even today, from different lawyers, you know, on advocacy and so on. For example, one thing I learned from Soli Dastoor, the great income tax lawyer, was he never interrupted the judge. The judge asked a question, he would just wait till he finished, which is a great lesson. So the first lesson I learned was, because of the strikes, going to court, spending hours and hours in court whenever the law college was not working. The other lesson I learned, thanks to the strike, was I started spending a lot of time in Connemara Library. I mean, if there's nothing in court, then I would go across to Edmore. And I would like to tell all the listeners that, at least in those days, I'm talking of the 77, 78, 79, we had, Connemara Library had a fabulous section on biographies. And within biographies, there was two full cupboards of legal biographies. And I got to read the biographies of great lawyers. I mean, there were biographies from England, from US, from India. India, there are so many interesting biographies which I got to read. I mean, we just know Roses in December. That's just one book. I don't know how many of you have got a chance to read the autobiography of K.N. Kadju, just as Markandeya Kadju's grandfather, Kailas Nath Kadju. A slim volume packed with wisdom, worth its weight in gold. So the second lesson that I learned was, and I would request all of you to devour, not read, just devour biographies. Read biographies, make your notes. There's so much to learn from biographies. In fact, in Connemara Library at that time, there were two fantastic books on advocacy. One was The Art of Advocacy by Lord Macmillan. It was called, he wrote with a pen name called Quintilian, but it was Lord Macmillan. And the other was Six Lamps of Advocacy by Lord Burkitt, by Norman Burkitt. So these were the points. No, just don't change the slides. I'll come to it later. Just go back to the first part. So these were the things I learned. So the second lesson that I learned was from lawyers, not only young, old, etc., is a lot to learn from biographies from the library. So this was a great learning experience for me, attending courts and so on. Now I straightway move on to joining the bar in 1980. I remember I got enrolled. I never knew that enrollment was such a big thing. And I was quite amazed. I'd come from Bombay. I mean, after Bombay, I had not seen this thing of crackers being burst on the enrollment day and hordes of people coming as if it's some kind of a mini wedding. And I had nobody. I didn't, and my parents were not there. Nobody was there. And I was all alone. And my friend Krishnamurti, who is now in Delhi, practices in Delhi, he moved my enrollment. And we were about 40 of us. I was the youngest at that time. So I was the last person to be enrolled. And after enrollment, I went to the third additional session with Judge. My senior was Mr. N. Natarajan on the criminal side, and his wife, Mrs. Ramani Natarajan, were my seniors. Now, one thing I had decided in college was that I wanted to be a tax lawyer. But I was also told that it is better to learn the basics of civil law before you go into tax practice, because that will stand you in good stead. And someone gave me the example of Ashok Sen, who they said was very good in civil law, criminal law. And he learned all these basics and then only specialized in tax law. So I said, okay, let me practice 1 year in civil law. I'd written everything down, 1 year in civil law, 3 years in the tax side. And I said that on the fourth year of my practice, I'll go independent. So I spent 1 year with Mrs. Ramani Natarajan, fondly called her Amma, and we had a wonderful set of chambers. We had lots of lawyers. I have very pleasant memories from 1980 to 81. And then 81 to 84, I joined the chambers of Subbarayar, Padmanabhan and Ramaman. And I had the opportunity of the 3 years spending mostly in the income tax appellate tribunal. As a junior, most junior, I would very often go to AAC or the CIT appeals and appear before them. And I think those 3 years in the tribunal were perhaps amongst the happiest I spent. I had wonderful colleagues. My friend Jay Kumar taught me a lot. Jay Kumar, Philip George, Janardhan Raja, who then became Justice Janardhan Raja, Ishwar, who became Justice Ishwar of the Delhi High Court. All of them helped me a lot and they still remain very good friends. So I learned a tremendous deal. One advantage of Ramamani's office was they had an absolutely fantastic library. And I, for the first time, I got to know what's the Queen's Bench and the King's Bench and all those Court of Appeals, all those books they had, and I would read them. You see, I had no vehicle of my own, so I would spend the afternoon reading in the library. So this habit stood me in great stead as far as is concerned. Now let me go to the slides which I made. Before that, I jotted down some points so that I finish everything within is X amount of time. Yes. For in the initial years for any person are very, very important. And if you're blessed with a good senior, blessed with good colleagues, that I think is a great, great blessing. And I was truly blessed to have wonderful seniors and wonderful colleagues at the bar. I didn't know the language very well. I had no family background in the law, but just the sheer help and as encouragement of all my friends pushed me along. And on 1st March 1984, which was exactly the fourth year of my joining the bar, I set out on my own practice with no briefs, no clients. And to this day, I'll never forget what Mr. Ramamani and Padmanabhan did. I was leaving the office and there was a heavy civil case. And Mr. Ramamani said that you're going on your own. You please take this brief and handle it yourself. And that really kept me away from that, brought in the necessary money for the first 2 years. The very big bank suit, which I took at that point of time. And it was very generous of Mr. Ramamani and Padmanabhan. Mr. Padmanabhan to help me at that point of time. Then that's all. I took off on my journey. And thereafter, I found that to my horror, work wasn't coming at all. I mean, I left the bar. I left Ramamani on the 1st of March. And 29th, it was 1984. It was a leap year. 29th February was my last year. Day and 1st March, I was in court and I just went to court and I had no work. Just going to the, Mr. Natarajan allowed me to use his chamber, 100 law chambers. And I started just going to court every day. But I was told that never sit at home, whether you are work or not, make sure that you go to court every day. Go to the court. So I would go to court, walk around the court sometime and then go to the library. And one way which kept me going was that apart from law, I had already started taking lectures. So that was some income which came in. So I was teaching at the Institute of Costs and Works Accountants of India. I was teaching at the Chartered Accountant Institute, teaching at the Company Secretaries, Natation Cooperative Training College, Bharadasan Institute of Management. So all these teaching classes kept me going, at least brought in some money because I'd also got married by that time. So any money from anywhere was welcome. So teaching helped me a lot. And you see, I happened to brief Keshwaninder at that point of time. And he gave me a lot of advice on how to practice and so on. And he said that no matter what happens, don't compromise. Don't compromise on your ethics. Time will come. You take time. Be patient and you will ultimately do well. He gave me lots of advice. There's no time to mention it now. But that was, briefing Mr. Keshwaninder was one of the most important parts of my life. 15 days I worked with him and I learned a lot from him in those 15 days, which I continue to try and practice even today. But I realized that there was no work coming in. And he told me that, look, your tax work won't pick up. You please do civil work and continue. So again, as you say, there was a setback and some guardian angel came on the way. There was a gentleman called Mr. Rajaram. He had a lot of criminal work and a lot of civil work as well. He was a remarkable man. He had worked in Spencer's for 10 years, but he always insisted on being a lawyer. So the moment he had some savings, he left and joined the bar, joined Western Australia. Now, he had a lot of civil work, and he asked me that, would you do my civil work for me? I said, yeah, I'll do it, but I had nothing else. And that's how I started. I remember I'd done quite a lot of rent control cases, rent control appeals, and I used to get 60 rupees per rent control case and 90 rupees per appeal in those days. So did a lot of work in the small causes court. I did a couple of motor accident cases, city civil court cases. Then Mr. T.N. Sitaraman, who had seen me in Ramamani's office, he once told me that he called me and said that Indian Express has a lot of civil litigation. Will you take it up? I said, yes. And that's how a lot of city civil court work came to me from the Indian Express group. Number of suits were filed against advertising agencies who are not paid and so on and so forth. And that contact with the Express ultimately, more than 12 years later, led to the Express, big Express case, which also was helpful. So what I wanted to mention was that things often go wrong. I thought when I leave Brahmani's office, I'll have immediately tax work coming in. So I had zero tax work at all. And things just went on. But my love was still tax. And apart from writing articles, I said, now it's the time to go to the next level. In law college, I set myself the target that before my 30th birthday, I'll write a nationally known book. And I realized that I was just looking what to write. I wanted to write a book. I said, because you see, we can't advertise, we can't solicit for work. The only way you will get known is to write art. I'd written articles, I was taking part in seminars and so on. But, you know, how do you get to the next level? That was the problem. So I said, let me write a book on a national level. So I had difficulties. I didn't want to write something which was not related to tax, because the book was to be a stepping stone to get better practice and be more well-known in the profession. I first started writing a book. You know, but coincidentally, I was doing a company case, and I found that in the Ramaya, there were some cases that had been missed out. So I wrote to Mr. Vadhwa in Nagpur saying that in your book, these cases are omitted. They are in the AIR manual, but they are not in your book. So coincidentally, Mr. Vadhwa had come down to Madras, and then he said that, why don't you write a book? I told him all my intention to write a book. He said, yes, right. So I chose Import-Export Control Act. Now, why did I choose the Import-Export Control Act, which then later became the Foreign Trade Development Act? The Import-Export Control Act of 1947, 71. I chose because it had about 15 articles, 15 sections. It was a small act. So I said that this is easy to write. I'll write this thing and get along. Now, it so happened that after I wrote the book, the Mr. Vadhwa said that, look, you have to give me procedures as to how the work will be done. I mean, no point just writing a book. You must tell us procedures, how to file a bill of entry, how to get your goods cleared and so on. And I said, I have no clue. He said, no, the book won't sell unless there's some procedure also. Ultimately, the market will be the business. Lawyers are a small market. So that book was ditched. Then I thought of writing a book, Central Excise Digest, a Customs Digest. I started work on it. My wife helped me a lot in getting those slips and getting all the basic things arranged. But again, we ran into copyright problems. And that project also failed. So from 84 to 86, all my writing efforts were simply wasted. 2 years had gone without writing. Again, a big setback. But just see how that setback leads to a better success. Again, Mr. Vadhwa came to Madras, and it so happened that in 86, moderate had just been announced, Central Excise. Central Excise tariff had just come. This was a completely new branch. You see, we had new tariff, new moderate. So excise law was the new law. So I told him, I said, yeah, I'll write this book, because income tax was already there. Ranga Palkewala was there, Sampath Iyengar was there. There were a lot of books on income tax, and it was like holding a candle against the sun. So there's no point doing that. So I started writing excise book, and I also made it very clear that I would write it on my own. There'll be no judge forward and all that. I'll just write it on my own. And he reposed full confidence in me, and finally the book came in 88. Now, this story, I'm spending some time for all my younger friends, for all those who want that. Writing a book has really, really helps a lawyer. I know there are a lot of young people who are writing. Mr. Vaidhi Suran is there, Mr. Arun Pandian is there. various other people are writing books. I mean, there are too many to name now, but writing a book always helps a lot. Ramanujan in Bangalore written a book. So writing a book always helped me. And just to give you an insight, the day year my book came, my income went up by 4 times the next year. That's the impact of writing a book. It was a brand new subject. It was a new thing, new area of practice. And that helped me quite a lot. And that's how the book wrote. And then after I wrote Excise book, I had always wanted to write a book on the Constitution. That finally came out in 2001. Again, it took a long time. I lost a lot of things because of a major virus problem. Again, big setback in the book. The book got delayed by almost a year and a half, but the book came. But the point which I want to mention to all of you is that I set a goal of writing a nationally known book, by the time I was 30. My Excise book came when I was 32. But I just think to myself, if I had not set the goal, I would never have written it because I had always planned. So one lesson to be learned is even if it gets delayed, even if there are setbacks, there's no need to get disheartened. You're on the track. If not now, tomorrow, it will come. But because if you say something, I'll do it by 2022, it may take 2024. But unless you set a target, it's not going to come. And with this, I'll now come to some of my slides. And I would request Srinivas or Prithvi to get onto the slides. I thought I'll show you some slides, which will perhaps help you.
Sure, sir.
And also enable me to do the finish lecture faster. Can we just
Yes, sir. I will. We'll share the screen now. Jayalakshmi.
Yes. Yeah. Am I audible on the mic? Is it all right?
It's fine, sir.
Yeah. So, you know, I just put down some thoughts of mine and I thought I'd share them with you because when you sit back and look back over a 40-year journey, 4 decades, I mean, if I was working, I would have retired 4 years ago. So, when you look back, what are the lessons you learned? And I thought that if I just put them down on paper, it may help many of you, and certainly the younger generation, they think about it or choose to follow it. You see, if you take Sirwai's book, and there's a very nice couplet he writes in the beginning of the book, and it says that, I've got it before me, "For all sad words of tongue and pen, the saddest are these, it might have been." So the saddest is it might have been. That's the saddest word, that is, this could have happened. And that led me to think, and in all the books that I've read, I realized that, as some author has said, that there are two versions of a particular person, who you actually are and who you are capable of being. What the writer Joe Dispenza calls the greatest ideal of yourself. So one thing which we should sit down and think is that, what is the greatest potential that we have? Where can we go? And what is the gap? I've been reading about this for quite some time. And recently, I saw an interview of Kobe Bryant, and who was a basketball player who died in a helicopter crash on 26 January 2020. And Kobe Bryant said that he set a target of being the greatest basketball player when he was 15 or 16. And then he made a menu of things. What is the gap between where he was and what he wanted? And started taking that item by item. Similarly, if we pause and think, you know, if we make a careful analysis, which is point number 3 here, write down everything. Where are we now? Where do we really want to be? Do you want to write a book? Do you want to win the national badminton championship? Whatever it may be, whatever your goal may be. Where are you are now and what you can be and how do you bridge the gap? And as they say in all these books, the famous formula is X to Y by when. You're at X, you want to be at Y, and by when. That when is the gap which you have to fill, and that's the most important thing. Now, I think of all the important things which I find is the most important thing is to have a clear goal or a clear target. And that is where I think many of us can really make a difference if you sit and set down very clear goals like, I'll do this by this particular age and so on. And of all the books I've read on goal setting, the best was in one video I had got by Zig Ziglar, which is the second slide. And I'll go to that. Please go to the next slide, slide number 3. Yes, Zig Ziglar makes 7 steps. He says, first, define the goal. Where exactly you want to be. I'll write a book on, say, electronic commerce by 2023. That's okay. That's a goal. That's the goal, writing a book. Then, second question is very important. Why are you doing it? What is the purpose? It should really motivate you internally, because there's no point doing a goal because somebody else wants you to do it. So many people say, you know, like, I want to do the IAS exam because my uncle wants me to be an IAS officer. I don't know. That is not really a proper motive. Do you really want to do it yourself? Ask yourself in your heart, do you really want to do it? Is it my real goal? Is it what really moves me? That's the second point. The third point is the deadline. Okay, I want to write a book on digital commerce by 2023. So deadline is very important. And the best definition of a goal is it's a dream with a deadline. You got a dream and you got a deadline. Combine the both and you have the goal. Then the third step is, what are the skills, knowledge necessary to achieve that goal? Then the fifth point is, who are the people who help you? Your seniors, your colleagues, your friends, your wife, your parents, all, you have to identify who are going to help you. Similarly, what are the obstacles? Because you're going to have obstacles. Maybe you got a part-time job. Maybe you got some family responsibilities. What are the roadblocks or points you have to work on? And that basically five and six is what we call a SWOT analysis. You have to sit down and analyze what are your strengths, what are your weaknesses, what are the opportunities, what are the threats. So make a 360-degree SWOT analysis. And then after all that, the last is the most important step, the plan of action. And that is where the rubber meets the road, the execution. And that's where, including me, we all fail, is that we have goals, but then we just falter. And I falter very often on the execution. We very often don't take the proper steps, or we make a new resolution and it doesn't. Incidentally, there's a study that new resolutions by the 14th of January, 94% of the people have already faltered on their new resolutions. So that is the kind of default rate. So kindly go to the next slide. The 7 steps is very important. If you can sit down and do it, it will help you a lot. Now, goal is not just a professional goal. It can be in these 4 areas. I would just suggest a health goal, family goals, professional goals, community goals, what contribution you want to make, work in social organizations, and so on. So these are the basic 4 areas. Now, can you go to the next one? Yeah. One of the most important thing is the thing of audacious goals. You know, the point is, the goal must really stimulate you. You should do something which is outside your comfort zone. And I always believe that it's only an audacious goal or a stretch goal which will motivate you to really do something spectacular. And it is here that I'll mention to all of you, I don't know how many of you heard a lady called Arunima Sinha. She's the first amputee to climb Mount Everest, and she's been a great source of inspiration to me. She's a young girl, 30-35, but she's already climbed all the 7 peaks, by the way, of mountain. So this lady was traveling from Muzaffarpur to some other place for some volleyball match, and some gundas tried to snatch her chain. She was thrown off the train. Her bad luck was, when she was thrown off, when she landed on the other track, another train went in the opposite direction, and her leg was cut, her spine was broken. And then she was there on the track for more than 11 hours. 47 trains went up and down. In the early morning, this happened at night. Early morning, some villagers noticed her. She was still breathing. She was still alive. She went to hospital and she recovered. I don't want to go into detail. But the most important thing is, the accident took place on the 11th of April, 2011. Because I've seen this video more than once. On 11th April, 2011, this is a girl who is in the hospital with a broken leg and a broken spine. And she sets the goal of climbing Mount Everest. Can you believe that? It's climbing Mount Everest. And from the hospital, she first goes and meets Bachendri Pal. And Bachendri Pal says, yes, if you have visualized and made up your mind, you have achieved half of it, you will climb it. And it's astonishing. It's really astonishing that by 23rd May 2013, in just 2 years and a month, she climbed Mount Everest. She was the first amputee to climb Mount Everest. Something phenomenal. So that's just a lesson to say that, you know, it's all within us. If you're really passionate, if you're mad about the goal, you can. And if you see the video, she said that morning, night, noon, she just thought of 8848, which was the height of Mount Everest. And she made it in 2 years. Now, the other point I would suggest to you, is because I've been doing all this study, is that don't just have a 1 year goal. That doesn't really motivate you. Better to have sub goals. Divide your 1 year into 90 days, into quarters, that 90 days, make it into a month, and then now make it into a week. So today is 1st June. Plan what you're going to do by 6th June. And that should dovetail into a 30-day goal, into a 90, which ultimately merges into your annual goal. The other important thing, which often I forget, but you should do it, is to have a daily review. More than a weekly review, daily review. There's a nice Japanese word called hansei, which says that you spend 15 minutes reflecting upon your day. At night, just think how the day went. Where did you go wrong? Where could you improve? So that's called hansei. And PDCA is a very common thing in management. It means plan, do, check, and act. First plan, then do it, then check what you have done, then make course corrections, and A. And I underline execution because that's where I fail, everybody fails, is the execution. We just don't implement what we have really planned. And the next point is goals and systems. There, I recently read a book, like all of you can buy it. It's called Atomic Habits. It's a very unusual title, Atomic Habits by James Clear. And he says that you don't reach your goals, the level of your goal. You descend to the level of your systems. So if your goal is to say, let us say, lose 10 kilos, that's a goal. But unless you have a system of diet and so on and so forth, you will not reach the goal. And that's where all of us, many of us, including me, fail, because we just have a goal, but we don't have the parallel systems. Other point I want to emphasize is visualization. There is no time. There's a lot of videos on visualization. And more I'm reading about this topic, about the importance of visualization. Visualizing your goal. Think it that it's already happened. And there are various steps which you can follow. Next. Other is one of my favorite topics, which I've been speaking on time management. In fact, last week I reread The Effective Executive by Peter Drucker. And he's got a lovely chapter called Know Thy Time. Know Thy Time. And one point I missed out here is he says that the starting point of time management is time tracking. He says for a week, analyze how you spend your time, maintain a time log, see how you have spent your time in half-hour intervals or 20-minute intervals. And I've done it and it's really embarrassing. You find that amount of time we waste on so many things is really shocking. And eventually, out of 12 hours, you really worked only for 3-4 effective hours. The time is just wasted. So this is the point I mentioned on time management. The second point I want to mention that I noticed in my own study that we don't waste hours. We generally waste minutes. We waste driblets of time. But that adds up in the whole day into several hours lost. I much like to work in time blocks of 90 minutes at a time or 60 minutes at a time. Set a timer and work flat out without any disruptions, no WhatsApp, no phone, nothing. That time blocking is a very, very important point. There is a good book by Cal Newport called Deep Work. That's worth reading. Time blocking. Then, of course, most important is after you have set your goals, daily goals, weekly goals, most important is to schedule them. What has to be done and so on. And one formula which I find is to first list out in the morning what are the three most important things you have to do that day, no matter what happens. That's priority A, B, C. That is most important. Then the remaining will follow. And item 5, I put in italics. I've read a nice book. It says that more important than a to-do list is a not-to-do list. You have to list the things which you will not do. That is far more important than a to-do list. It's not just humorous, but I find it to be very true. I try to make a list of what things I should not do. And that really helps as well. Then the next slide. These are all things which I have from my old notes, which all books I have read, I've just jotted on several points. And I just, for this lecture, thanks to Jay Kumar, I try to put them into a few slides so that it will help all of you in your own way, because these are all things which I've learned over the years. Now, as far as lawyers are concerned, doctors are concerned, any professional is concerned, I've learned certain things which I will just, I put them down in a few points. First and most important is there is simply no shortcut. I mean, if you're aiming to be get to the top of the profession, there is what Stephen Covey calls law of the farm. You have to plant the seeds. You have to wait for the seed to germinate. The crop will grow. It has to be then harvested. You can't short circuit it beyond a point. So patience and the law of the farm, very important. Please read Malcolm Gladwell's Outliers, the 10,000 hour rule. It's not just 10,000 hours of work, it's 10,000 hours of deliberate work. Again, you work and you keep seeing whether you're doing the right thing. 10,000 hour rule is very important. So the first thing is patience and time. And I'll just go back when I was reading all the books in Connemara Library, I told you all the biographies. One thing I learned was, except perhaps Palkhivara and a couple of people, Jethwalani, all had a long waiting period. So if all of us are going to wait to get practice success, don't be disheartened. It is part of the game. That's the general rule rather than the exception. MC Settlewar, 10 years no work, 9 years no work. Chagla, 8 years no work. So many examples are there where people had to keep on waiting for that. ST Desai was a great tax lawyer. He had work, no work. So he started writing books. His famous Law of Partnership was written in the briefless days. So these are the things, so no shortcuts at all. The other second point I thought I will tell you is mastery over your field. You take up one subject and it's better to be a complete specialist or the boss, so to speak, in one subject, whether it's tax or excise or whatever it is. You have to be a master in any particular subject. As they say, you can't be a wandering generality. You have to be a meaningful specific. That's what Zig Ziglar says. Don't be a wandering generality. The third thing is single-minded focus. You heard that law is a jealous mistress. Is that I very often find that people want to be great lawyers, but they also want to join Rotary. They want to join Masonry. They want to do all kinds of things. Let me tell you, it's not possible. It all depends. I mean, if you want to get to the top, then it has to be law and nothing else. And you'll have to necessarily sacrifice a lot of things. Just keep one or two other social activities if you like, but it's, I don't think you can have a very hectic social life and again get anywhere to the top of your profession. That's my personal view. Single-minded focus is extremely, extremely important. I've already mentioned about observing your seniors, learning from them. You should be, I think, like a sponge, constantly observing, whether you're 20, 30s, 40, 50, 60. I think every day is a learning experience. Every day you learn from people and so on. And one thing I'll tell all of youngsters particularly, keep a notebook. I had the habit of keeping a notebook. Whenever anybody made a, you know, I would hear M.R. Narayan Swamy arguing, if you refer to some case, I would note it down and try and read it later in the evening. And six is very important, the litigation landscape. You know, I observed that in the 50s, the litigation was mainly zamindari litigation, land litigation. Then you come to the 60s and 70s, that became less. You had more of public law. Writ started picking up. By the time I came, joined the bar in 80, writ, there were already three or four benches hearing writ matters. So writs had picked up quite a bit. Before that, all the great lawyers, Kesho Iyengar, Gopal Swami Iyengar, very many people were all leading civil lawyers. They were first appeals, second appeals, LPAs and so on. There, but that work slowly got dwindled and writ work and other work picked up. Now, in my own case, when I found that excise was the new tariff and the new moderate, I focused on that and it paid me rich dividend. So people, the younger generation can think of what is the future landscape like. We are moving into a digital world. We are moving into an e-commerce world. Now they say that in 2025, almost 40% of all transactions or 50% will be through the electronic media. Then that leads to so many opportunities. Civil litigation will be, how is it going to be affected? How is tax going to be affected? Cross-border taxation and so on. So that is the, you have to sit and think, where is the future litigation? Are you going to be ready for it? We'll have to start preparing ourselves right now. The next one. And just one more slide and we are done. Eight. Yes. These are also thoughts when Jay Kumar told me to say about this 40-year journey, I was just sitting down and thinking what happened in the last four decades. And one thing I realized, that things will go wrong. They always go wrong. Murphy's Law. Only thing is, you have to course correct. There's an old story that a plane which goes from, say, Bombay to Chennai, it's constantly being pushed out of target. But once it knows its destination, it keeps making course correction and locks on to what it achieves. So once your goal is set, once your thing is set, then all this buffeting should not take you off guard. Secondly, I want to mention is no comparison. I learned that there is no point comparing yourself to X or Y. You'll always feel disheartened. Jealousy sets in, envy sets in. Rather, you benchmark, you try to learn what are the plus points of a particular role model and just try to improve yourself. Like there was a very, like this Kobe Bryant, they kept asking, are you a bigger basketball player or Michael Jordan is a better basketball player? So he said that, please stop comparing. He's got his own plus points. I got my own plus points. I just try to be the best version of myself. I'm not going to compare myself to Michael Jordan. The third point is, success leaves clues. Always you learn, how did X person achieve success? What are the steps he took? Suppose I take those steps, right? So you try to emulate those points, like, you know, writing a book, or like if you're playing badminton, what are the steps that isn't taken by a great badminton player? Suppose I take those steps, what will happen? So they say success leaves clues. It's a formula. You follow those clues and you'll also get success. Fourth is make sure you give it your all. And that's very important, that when you ultimately come to the end of your professional career, you should have the satisfaction that I did everything humanly possible to get going in the profession. I didn't leave any stone unturned. Five and six are very, very, very important, and we don't pay enough attention to it. We don't realize how important our thoughts are. And there is a saying that the seven most important words are, you are what you think about all day. So if you, what you ultimately manifest in reality is what you keep on thinking. And don't have any illusions. Thoughts are incredibly powerful. And if you just analyze, what you keep thinking turns into actions. Actions become behavior. Behavior becomes personality. There's a very good YouTube video of Joe Dispenza. Joe Dispenza, who explains this very, very nicely. Thoughts, actions, behavior, and personality. So if you're going to achieve your goals, then you have to be very careful about your thoughts to start with. That affects action, behavior, personality. Now, we don't normally think about this, but this you have to think. And recently, I saw a nice video. We all know the magic word, abracadabra, is a magician's word. You know? Like a magic wand, he says abracadabra, and the magic trick takes place. And that word has got a very important meaning. It's an Aramaic word. It's before the Hebrew language, also very ancient language. It says, and pay attention to this very carefully, it says that what you speak is what you create. So if you take item 5 and 6 in my slide, your thoughts and your words ultimately will play a large role in shaping your destiny. What you think and what you speak, what you talk to yourself, will all ultimately. Finally, random thoughts. I'm now coming to my end. Please be grateful. We all keep complaining, but we have lots to be grateful about. A nice family, happy colleagues, all this. You know. Second point is very important. Money is a byproduct in a profession. I would advise all of you, never chase money for the sake of money. Money will come as a result of your professional excellence and because people want your expertise. Other thing is stimulus and response. The one thing which distinguishes a human being from an animal. These are all my random thoughts which I thought I'll share with you. One thing which distinguishes a human being from an animal is that we can choose a response to a stimulus. So whatever attractions are there, whatever stimuli are there, it's our choice to either be tempted by it and do something, or we can stop and say, no, it's not proper. So stimulus and response is important. YouTube videos, it's one of the biggest advantages of the modern era is the kind of information that's available on YouTube. Virtually everything you have, very good videos, which can be a great learning experience. Then there's a nice saying of which I've learned from Les Brown. If you do things others do not do, you will have things others do not have. So what it means is keep doing the exceptional and good. Sixth is again a fantastic sentence. All achievement is outside the comfort zone. You can never achieve anything unless you get really uncomfortable. And it's a discomfort which produces achievement. And finally is whatever happened yesterday is over. The past is a bucket of ashes and every day is a new beginning. So I'll tell all my friends that today, 1st of June, should be a new beginning for all of us. And we should try to work to becoming the best version of ourselves, becoming the greatest ideal of what we potentially can be. And with that, I thank Jaykumar, I thank Prithvi, I thank everybody. And I must say that today, whatever the successes and setbacks, I must thank my grandparents, my parents, my wife, my children, who all have been constant source of support. And thank you very much. I've gone on a bit longer, but I thought that these thoughts may also encourage all of you. Thank you and wish you all the very best.
Thank you very much, sir. Indeed, after conducting a series of academic lectures, we wanted this in one of our ending lectures, because we've been given a roadmap of how to achieve greatness from a legend like you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. And I thank Jaykumar, sir, also for organizing this webinar. Sir, there have been a few requests from our participants. I just want to ask one question, sir, which one of our participants had put up. So, his question is, which would be of great importance to all of us also.
Yes, please.
You said that set a high goal. What was the goal which you had set for yourself in your early life? And how did you work towards it, sir?
In law college in 77, 78, in the first year, I set a goal of being a tax lawyer. I said, I'll do 1 year of civil practice, 3 years of tax practice. And I said, I'll start independent on the fourth year. Then I set the goal of writing the first well-known book of mine at the age of 30. I also set a goal that after the book I write, the next book, I'll write a book on the Constitution. So these two goals I set. Of course, I didn't do it by 30. I did it when I was 32. But this was the goal which I set. And finally, I wrote the exercise book, which was almost 2,000 pages in the first. It took me 2.5 years to write. And to tell everybody, I didn't see a single movie for 2 years, from 86 to 88. So I just, every spare moment was spent in writing the book. So I did set that high goal. So, because unless the goal is really high, audacious, ambitious, it will not motivate you. No point saying I learned 20 rupees more. No, it has to be something new. And one to tell the audience, you know, people ask me, can I set some absurd goal? I mean, how do I know I'm going to achieve it? One thing is, it should not be so absurd. Like today, I can't say I'll win the Wimbledon championship. It's not going to happen, no matter what I try. But you set a goal which is outside your comfort zone, which you can attain. And I take the example of Aranyama Sinha. If a person with a broken leg can climb Mount Everest, we can do virtually anything in that sense. But the advantage of having a high goal is that you motivate it. Now, to answer the question, will I achieve it? There is one psychological rule that you will not have the goal. That is, it will not be in your heart unless you are capable of its achievement. You will have the goal which is you are capable of. Arunima Sinha had the goal of climbing Mount Everest. She is capable of achieving. So, if you have got an ambitious goal, just go for it. Just go for it. You will stumble, you will fall, but you will achieve it.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, there are two more queries, sir.
Yeah,
if time permits, sir, if we can just...
Because very frankly, I owe everything to the Madras bar. So this way I can do a little... I mean, my happiest moments were spent at the Madras tax bar, yeah.
Thank you so much. Sir, it's one question, sir. You said there is a 10... Sir, I'm sorry, sir.
10,000 hours.
Yes, sir. There is a 10,000 hour rule in law. So, how can you elaborate more on that, sir, on behalf, like, for youngsters like us? How what is that hour rule which we have to follow, sir?
Yeah. See, 10,000 hour rule is by a writer called, actually it's by a person, a professor called Anders Ericsson. He found out that to achieve mastery in any subject, you have to spend 10,000 hours. And for example, he did a survey of violinists in Berlin, in Vienna. And they found that a person who practiced for 2,000-3,000 hours, he became a music teacher. Somebody who did 5,000 hours, he did slightly better. But the guy who did 10,000 hours, he ultimately became a world-class violinist. And that 10,000 hour rule is deliberate practice, not just practicing, but you practice, keep on improving on a daily basis, and that's how you do it. Take Kobe Bryant, whom I greatly admire. Others used to practice 2 sessions of 2 hours each. He had 4 sessions of 2 hours each, starting at 4 o'clock and ending at 8 o'clock. So the point is, he reached 10,000 hours much faster. So if you want to master law, and you must have at least 10,000 of inputs. This is not only for violin players, for surgeons, the Beatles, you know, the music group Beatles. They became great because they were playing 8 hours a day in Germany. So the 10,000 hour rule is ultimately you achieve mastery by repeatedly doing something in an improved fashion, and that's 10,000 hours. So suppose you work for 8 hours a day, then in 200 days a week, you're working 1600 hours. So basically 6 to 7 years, you will achieve your mastery. You read the book Outliers, the book called Outliers.
Outliers.
Outliers, O-U-T-L-I-E-R. In statistics, we got the mean, median. So things which are off the mark, they are called outliers. The book by Malcolm Gladwell. It's worth reading. He discusses this 10,000 hour. And there's another book by Anders Ericsson called Peak. P-E-A-K. Please read those books.
Sir, there is one question, sir, which is more we want to hear that from you, sir. Your advice for tax enthusiasts of today.
Tax enthusiasts.
Yes, sir.
I would say, please focus on digital taxation, cross-border taxation, because we are going to face a lot of problems with e-commerce disputes. Permanent establishment, is a server a permanent establishment? How are you going to tax a cross-border transaction? You've got equalization levy which has come. So I would seriously recommend everybody to deeply study e-commerce, electronic commerce, and see the tax implications of that, because that could be a lot of thing which you have to grapple with. I'm also very totally unsure. Vaidheeswaran has written a good book on taxation of e-commerce. There are other books also, which you should please read and follow.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, there are a few members from our bar who would like to personally ask you a few questions, sir. We'll, with your permission, we take a couple of questions.
Yes. Then, sir. Most welcome.
Thank you very much, sir. First, I would unmute Mr. Aditya Reddy. He wanted to ask a question. Aditya, sir,
yes.
Turn on your camera also, sir. It is a request.
That's okay, Aditya.
Hi, Aditya. Turn on the video. Hi, Aditya. How are you?
I'm not formally dressed. Sorry. Sir, that's okay.
Okay. Doesn't matter.
Just a couple of things. One is, sir, I was wondering, because this is a handicap in case of some lawyers, what do you think is the, say, the ratio of the role of things like, say, court craft or eloquence, etc., sir, to the more concrete virtues of, say, hard work and, intelligence for a person's success in the profession, sir, because that is one. Just another one on the slightly on the lighter side, sir. I thought, how did you stumble upon the idea of sending a manuscript to a pantry car to Nagpur, sir? How did you first? How did that first occur to you to send it to Mr. Vardhan?
No. Yeah. Manuscript to pantry car. I think. Okay. Now I'll just tell you. One is about this. The first question is importance of court craft. I think court craft is very, very, very important. Otherwise, you can simply give written submissions and the judge can decide. Very often, and as they say, that what you say is just 8%. How you say it is a large, higher percentage of what you say. In fact, you know, there's a lovely quote of Cicero. Cicero was a great Greek statesman. He said, if truths were self-evident, eloquence would be unnecessary. And your people like Demosthenes, Edmund Burke, Cicero would sway audience. So I would say court craft is very important. And that's why, as I mentioned in the beginning, when the law college used to go on strike, I used to go to court and I used to see how people argued. You see, the method, Vyas Chitale put a case, was very nice, very pleasant. R.K. Garg had a very aggressive style of advocacy. Ram Jethmalani had his own style. So you could try to note down interesting points as to how they argued the case. I mentioned about Dastoor. Very polite, he never irritated a judge. Some judges, lawyers would be abrasive, some would be very polite. Each had got his own style of advocacy. You can't copy somebody, that will not look, it will look very odd. But you can take these minor points from everybody and put it into your own way and court craft. And another thing of court craft is to keep arguing as many cases as you can. Now, about this pantry car waiter. You see, when it's not my idea, it's Mr. Vadwa's idea. When I was writing the excise book from 87 to 86, 87, 88. You know, there was no what you call, the book was written on a typewriter. We didn't have any computer. There was no Word, nothing. So if one mistake was there, everything had to be jumped and done again. So we used to have those, I would send the manuscript by post. Now, there was no, you'd be surprised that as late as 87, 88, there was no courier. Can you believe it? We had no courier to Nagpur. And post would take a long time. So what to do? Every night, the Tamil Nadu Express used to leave Chennai and reach Nagpur at 2 o'clock the next morning. So me and my wife would go to station. And in that tunipai, you know, that nalli tunipai or some tunipai which you take something, I would keep all those papers, give it to some pantry car waiter called Murugan or Subramaniam or Subbu or somebody. And then come out of central station. This was STD booths. We had no... So stand in the line, make the damn STD call. Sometimes the call won't go. And call Mr. K.K. Vadwa or his brother S.K. Saab and tell him that Muttu pantry car waiter is there. So they would collect the back from Muthu at Nagpur. Similarly, the proofs which will be sent, they'll send with some other person on the pantry car. And either I would go early morning to Central Station and pick it up, or my cook was there. He would go and pick it up from Central Station that for correction. So this is how we did the manuscripts. And my junior Kuberan helped me a lot. He looked after my work in Madras when I was there. And I used to keep going to GT very often, no reserves. So I would sleep on the compartment on the ground and make a berth and just go to Nagpur the next day for corrections. So that was, it's difficult to believe in the 40 years how much technology has changed. Now the latest edition of Kanga and Palkiola, I've done everything sitting in my house in Annanagar just by digital methods. Thanks, Aditya. I don't know who told you about this pantry car thing, but anyway.
Sir, he's muted again. I'll just unmute. So, sir, next question. I would unmute Mr. Natarajan. He also wants to. Natarajan, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So, very good evening, sir. If you were taught. Fine, sir. So even at this age, I'm nearing 50, if your thought can be so encouraging for such a person, how it would have been encouraging for today's youngsters, nobody need to tell about that. Actually, we all felt the goosebumps. And I just want to know, you are academically inclined also. You have been visiting a lot of law colleges and all and addressing the students and all. And how do you see the present generation, especially the law, the students? Are they all properly focused and promising? Or they are all for this quick money, quick fame kind of a thing. So how is your assessment of the current day community of law students? How promising they are? Or is there any cause of worry as far as these youngsters are concerned?
Yes, I'll be frank. Because what happens is we have two interns every month. So we've been having a lot of interns over the years. And now the plus point is I find generally the younger generation without exaggeration far, far brighter than what we were. I mean, when I see a 22-year-old or a 20-year-old boy giving me a draft, I can honestly say that I was not capable of doing it even at the age of 25. So, I can definitely say without any fear of contradiction that the younger generation is far more intellectually capable than ours, our generation. That's my opinion. On the minus side, I feel that they are very much in a hurry. They want everything within 2 years and 3 years. I keep telling them that it took me 10 years to buy my first second-hand old car. Srinivasan, that old 1990 Toyota. So, that was after 10 years of practice. I bought my first typewriter after 6 years. So, you must wait, must have patience. The other thing which I find among the younger generation which they can think of is that everybody wants to go abroad for an LLM. I don't see what is the logic. So, that's what is called herd mentality. So, please think whether it's worth it. And the last thing is everybody straight away wants to go to Supreme Court. So I keep telling the young generation that you be patient. You work, doesn't matter if it's Jabalpur High Court or it's Goa or it's whatever it is. There's a lot of work in the local courts. And especially people from the law schools, the better law schools. They're so capable, they're good, they articulate, they're able to draft. And the younger generation has the fantastic advantage of the internet. You see, they've got the entire library of the world on their fingertips, which we never had. If we had some, we had to take special permission, go to the judge's library. We had nothing. Everything was in hard copy. So this present generation is fantastic. I think if they just develop some more patience. But on the whole, when I see young lawyers arguing in other courts and so on and so forth, I think the future is very bright. I have no, I don't say that our generation is good. No. Younger fellows are much, much brighter. No doubt.
Thank you.
And anyway, I must congratulate you. You're also a person who writes books. So I'm very happy with that.
Yeah, in fact, you were kind enough to write the introduction for that. And I saw you sitting in the airport and reading my script and writing the introduction. But that is your commitment. Thank you, sir.
Very good book. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, I have been flooded with a lot of questions, but I'm sure there is some paucity in time. We cannot take up all the questions.
I can take them for 15-20 minutes. No problem. They are so interesting.
Okay, so in the next 15 minutes, we'll try to take up as many queries as possible, sir. And before we move on to the next question, to all the participants who are able to join us a little late or you were not able to join from the beginning, we will be uploading this session on our YouTube channel. That is Madras Tax Bar Chennai. So you can always catch up with the session there. The channel link will be shared by my friend Nitin. You can please have a look into that. So, sir, the next question, I would just unmute Dr. Krishnanand.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. I can't see you.
One minute. Yes, sir.
Hello, how are you?
Fine, thank you, sir.
Nice to see you after a long time.
Yes, sir. At least we met in the corridors of the Supreme Court a couple of times.
We met in the Supreme Court, yes.
And you reminded me about the port services. My question is again about the same thing. Port services. You appeared for me, on behalf of me and my clients in port services, on almost 25 to 30 occasions for the Madras High Court. Now, for you and I, when I briefed you, we thought it was just a matter of a minute where the judge would catch the point and he would decide it in our favor after the amendment to the Act came. But surprisingly, even after 25 occasions of hearing, the judge did not catch the point. The judge, I don't want to name the judge or the bench or whatever it is. And then ultimately, from Bangalore, the matter went up to the Supreme Court. Now, after 40 years of practice, you and I, for a moment, thought that the matter will be over in a jiffy, in a minute. But then the judge couldn't catch the point. Now, how do you absorb this kind of a reaction of a judge who cannot understand the very basic tenets of the amendment, which turned the table completely in favor of the SSC? You took it very casually, and you, of course, looking at the side, looking at me, you told me, this dumb guy can't understand, what is this? How many times you want me to appear in this matter? Now, how do you deal with these kind of cases? See, at your age, your experience, you're able to manage it, you just gulp it down your throat. But for the younger generation, sometimes, you know, people lose their cool. In the sense that you're trying to say something which is obvious, but still the other side, the judge does not want to understand that. So what is your advice to people like me or people, the other younger people who have a similar point of view?
See, I'll tell you what. This is part of the system. There's nothing you can do. From 1980, in fact, there's a senior lawyer called G. Narayan. He told me a story of B. Tyagarajan. B. Tyagarajan was a very great lawyer. So, I'm talking of the days of the 50s, so it's not something new now. So, T. Tyagarajan was trying to explain a point to the judge. He just couldn't follow. He just couldn't get the point. And so, when they came to the chamber for lunch, G. Narayan, as a junior, told him, "Sir, judge is sitting on a muck, sir." All right. So, Tyagarajan was having some idli dropped. He said, "Tambi, judge muck kadeyadu. He is a nidipati. We should try to make him understand. It is our job." So, what I look at it this way, it's part of the system because we don't have specialized judges. You'll have a judge from the civil bar deciding a tax matter, you'll have a tax judge deciding a criminal case. So, I find it very, very, you know, even today after so many years, sometimes a new judge comes in the Supreme Court or in some other high court. We explain to him reopening of assessment, fundamentals is so simple. We think it's so elementary, but we're not able to understand. So, I look at it this way. This is a problem which is there for the last 70 years. It is going to be there for the next 50 years. As long as we don't have a completely dedicated, specialized, which Ramaman used to tell me that, you know, he didn't like to come to the High Court. He said, "I can finish 3 cases in the tribunal per day. It takes me 3 days to argue a case in the High Court." So, he used to not come to the High Court because of that. So, 2 points I'll tell you. One is, there's nothing you can do about it. It's just luck. Suppose you get a good judge, a quick judge, you are lucky. Otherwise, secondly, I try to tell myself, why don't we try it as a lesson to improve our advocacy? Why don't we try to put it in such a way that even a person who doesn't understand can understand? That's the only way I take it. So, and I just try to see, and then I use it as a learning thing of being more patient, trying different approaches. So, when I'm arguing for a judge who doesn't know, in the early morning, I try to put plan A, plan B, plan C. I'll say, if this doesn't work, I'll go to this. If this, that doesn't work, I'll go to that, and so on and so forth. So, I just keep trying that. But this, you can't get disheartened, because what happens for every two judges who don't understand, you have two judges who understand the subject. It's not that everybody is dense. So, that's just part of it. You just have to take it in your stride and move on. Because, I mean, I just enjoy going to court. One thing I miss today is just the sheer oxygen of arguing in court. So it's part of the game. That's where you find I never got very upset. This is an elementary point. And one thing you don't forget, as a tax bar, it's a very specialized bar. If you go to a criminal lawyer, he understands something in a minute, which you and I will take 2 hours to understand. Because he's doing it day in and day out.
Just one more point. In one matter, regarding photocopiers. I don't know whether you remember it or not. It came before Justice MJJ when he was sitting as he was then. And the other side advocate suddenly passed a very caustic and personal remark against you. So normally when a senior is arguing the matter, I never open my mouth. I just keep shut. So you never reacted to the caustic remark. But I was very personally offended. And when I stood up, you pulled me by my gown and said, sit down, don't react. I said, nothing doing. I cannot take this nonsense from somebody. You're appearing for me. He makes a personal remark against you. And the judge came to the conclusion that ultimately the other side had to apologize. Why didn't you react, sir? Where a personal remark is made against you in the open court.
Yes. You read M.C. Settlegod's autobiography, My Life and Lawing. There is one sentence where he says that he took a decision never to react to what the other side says. Because A, I kept that in mind. I said I should never lose my temper if somebody else says A, that makes my advocacy suffer. Secondly, I'm giving importance to him. He's saying something. He should not make a personal remark. If he doesn't know legal etiquette, why should I get down to his own level? Like the old saying of Buddha. Buddha was, somebody said, I will disturb Buddha. So he kept on accusing Buddha of all sorts of things, of being totally a rich man, using all sorts of allegations. He kept smiling. Then that fellow finally prostrated and said, I said all this against you. Why didn't you react? He said, if you give me a gift and I don't accept it, whom does it belong? So I realized that these people talk, in the Sahara case, Mr. Jethmalani made such strong remarks against me, He said, in the vacation, you please learn content law and this and that. He made very personal remarks. I didn't react at all. I kept arguing my own case. Justice Keher remarked that, look, and what happened after that, he was fumbling for an authority, Jethmalani. And I told him, this is the citation across the bar. So Keher told me that, look, Mr. Nathar, he kept on making accusation. You never reacted. And when he wanted help, you came to say, this is what we like. So he was very calm. I also realized, okay, if Jethmalani is making a statement against me, it's all right, I don't bother. So I always tell people, and secondly, I always say the court is like a temple of justice. We should never foul that atmosphere. Shouting, etc., what happens? You lose the decorum and dignity. We are all officers of court. So that I learned from all these things I culled out in various notes, This of not reacting is from Settlegod's autobiography.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. See you in the Supreme Court soon.
Hopefully, I don't mind going to some court.
No, you have to appear for my court services in the kinshipping case, which you're still keeping a watch on.
Yes. Hopefully, you're a good judge. Yes, we'll keep a watch.
Best.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for answering that question, sir. Sir, I'm going to unmute Mr. V.S. Jayakumar, sir. And after even Mr. Vaidishwaran, sir, wants to tell something, sir. So, I'll first unmute Mr. Jayakumar, sir.
Qatar, you are...
Good evening.
Hi, Jayakumar, how are you?
Hi, you are one of the awesome lawyer I've seen from the first day.
Pardon?
I met you.
Hello?
You're one of the awesome lawyer. I've learned a lot from you professionally, personally, emotionally, in several occasions. I remember the days that you used to come in the scooter to Connemara Library, YMIA, having lunch with me for 90 paise with a curd, 10 paise more. And your extraordinary performance in Supreme Court in deferred tax and accounting standards, as Kapadia said, senior lawyers are learned from Mr. Datta. He is the man who should start. I'm talking to my elder brother. So thank you very much, Datta. I learned a lot from you. Rudiments of everything.
Actually,
thank you very much.
Actually, I learned from you, Philip George Raja, all the basics from taxation. What is first appeal? Ishwar, all of you taught me. I remember the wonderful days we had in the tribunal. And thanks for taking a scooter to YMI, etc. I had no bus, I had no car, nothing I know. And we used to go on and have that lunch for 2 rupees and 40 paise. That's lovely memories. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Arvind. Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. So, I'll unmute Mr. Raghavan Ramabhadran, sir. And after that, I'll take a question from Mr. Vaidishwaran, sir. Raghavan, sir?
Yes, yes. Sir, hello. Raghavan here.
Hello, how are you? Nice seeing you. Tell me.
Good, good. Sir, I just wanted to ask one question, sir. As a final year law student, sir, many people even ask me whether they should go for general laws and then learn all those things, or they should immediately go for specialization. This has always been a very difficult question for many people. So what is your take on that, sir? What do you suggest? Should people aim for specialization? I heard you that you wanted to do 1 year of civil practice and then 3 years of tax practice and then go on your own. So what do you think, according to you, is a good formula there, sir?
Yeah, I've been telling all my interns that don't go for specialization. It's like this, you see, before you go for neurology or anything, you have to go, become, do your house surgeoncy, do the basics medicine. And looking back, if I had to live my life again, I'd do 1 year civil, 1 year criminal, and then take up tax. That's one mistake I made. So I learned this from Ashok Sen's life. That, yes. And other person worth example, Mr. V.R. Manohar of Nagpur. He is a complete general lawyer. So I think every lawyer should learn 1 year of civil law, go to city civil court, go to a small cost court. That's where the real India is. No point straight away coming to air-conditioned Supreme Court. Then do 1 year of criminal law. See what's a bail, what's an anticipatory bail, what's a trial. Learn the basics of CPC and CRPC, and then you do your specialization. You go for patent law or trademark law. That's always my belief. And you see what happens? Like, everybody wants to do computers. So everybody wants to do corporate law. Everybody wants to do tax law or whatever the flavor of the season is. But I'm very, very clear in my mind. 1 year civil, 1 year criminal. And don't be in a hurry. I finished 40 years. I'll be in the bar for another 30 years. So this 2 years doesn't really matter. It's an investment. It's better than any LLM in any foreign degree. But this basic grounding of civil and criminal law.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. It was wonderful, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, I'll unmute Vaidheshwaran, sir. And I see a question from Arvind Pandian, sir, as well as NL Raja, sir, also wants to add something, sir. So I'll just unmute them after Vaidheshwaran.
Hello.
Yeah,
hello.
Hello.
Good evening,
Vaidheshwaran, sir. Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Dadar.
Hello, how are you?
Very good, thank you. It was wonderful listening to you and what a journey it has been, and these kind of snippets are so rare to get. And let me say this, that I know many may not know, but Mr. Dutta has always been a role model, and I've been watching him and trying to emulate as much as I can. This is like a package deal which is offered through this webinar. So much.
I was very skeptical. I don't know if people will like this, or I just thought I'll put the slides in.
It was brilliant, and your reference to those atomic habits and things like that, I've heard in the airport about that book, and I spoke to you once, and I caught you in Delhi, and that book has really made a difference at different points of time. The one point I thought I'll ask from you, you've handled many matters on at various courts at full speed and moving from one court to other with different bundles and all those peak periods when you're running from bundle to court to court. How do you manage the stress that comes along with it, and how do you deal with it? The pressure. Pardon? That happens, but how do you deal with
the stress? I lost your voice.
How do you deal with the stress and pressure when you're handling about 12, 14 matters a day?
How do you manage 3-4 matters?
Yeah. How do you seamlessly move through bundles, yes, and how do you manage the pressure?
Well, see, as you, first of all, now I've reduced it. I don't do anything but tax and constable. I mean, I was doing many more matters. On a Monday, I would have 7, 8 SLPs, 9 SLPs or whatever. I basically have a strategy. You know, I give more time to a petitioner's brief than a respondent's brief. So suppose a respondent brief, and if it's a tax brief, I know typically the amount is more than 100 crores, they're going to issue notice. So I don't spend too much time, because in an SLP, you have very little to say as a respondent, number one. So if it's a petitioner's matter, I give more time. So I basically divide the case into ABC category. C are routine respondent, which just go away. Then B are where you're on caveat, you have to make something, you have to oppose the stay, where you do some more reading. And petitioners are the case where I do really spend a lot of time, especially if it's going to be a difficult bench, then you read, do that much more reading and be ready for it. So you just divide the work in such a way. That's how you do it. Yeah. And unfortunately, even then, after that, some matters get passed over, they don't read, they get adjourned, but that's part of the game. Nine. So that's how I divide my work. A, B, C category.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
And thank you so much for those nice words about the book.
Yeah, no. I've been telling people, I said, there's the litigation of the future, you know, that should read it. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Actually, I didn't know you're watching the show. Yeah.
How can I miss your session?
Sir, I have unmuted Arun Pandian, sir, as well as NL Raja, sir. Yeah. Arun Pandian, sir?
Yeah. Sir, you are able to hear me, sir?
Yeah, I'm able to hear you. Yeah.
NL Raja, sir, I have also unmuted you, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, Raja, thank you.
Finish first, so you can add.
Go ahead, Arun.
Arun, I can't hear you. Can you tell me again?
Sir, you are able to hear me, sir?
Hello. Sir, Arun, what you can do is... Yeah, now I can hear you. I can hear you now.
Okay. Sir, a wonderful lecture as well as also guidance, I should say, for many of us, including whether we call ourselves old or seniors, whatever. Sir, as Vaidhi said, thank you very much for giving us this opportunity to see you in this form. Sir, I have two questions to you. The first one is, sir, I should say a person like me is lucky because I have a mentor like you. So I have maybe had guidance as and when I require from a person like you whom I have treated as a mentor. What is the role of the present juniors to look out for, I should say, mentors, and how, what kind of mentors they should look at, and mentoring, how they should kind of start apart from reading? Your views on advising the juniors about choosing a mentor. The second question, sir, is people like many of us who are listening to you today have also completed 20 to 25 years of practice also. For us, people who are touching the 40s or the 50s, people like me who have just touched 50, what would you advise us? I won't use the word, sir, career as such, but wherever we have reached, what do we typically look at day to day from where we are now? You have advised a lot from the juniors angle or the beginners or the youngsters professional. We don't want to use the word youngsters, but starting from where we are, what is your second part of our life which you think we should look at?
Yeah. Shall I answer?
Yeah, please, sir.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, as far as juniors are concerned, there are two ways you can get a mentor. Either you are blessed to have a senior like Ramamani or Padmanabhan or Mr. Ravi Natarajan. So, they themselves give you guidance. Second is, I think you have to be like a sponge. You just get mentored by observing people, because you can only work with one senior. You can't work with multiple seniors. You'll be only with one senior. At the same time, suppose like, you know, you have a lot of work, let's say hypothetically in the CLB or the NCLT. I come with you as your junior. I not only learn from you, but I also see the other seniors appearing. And I should keep taking notes. What is the other plus point? What can I learn from him? What can I do? What are the cases he argues? How is his preparation? That's the second. Thirdly, I was very curious. I would keep asking people questions. Like when I met Andhirajuna, for example, I would keep asking what was Seerwai's working method, what was so-and-so's working method, how did so-and-so work. And again, when I wrote Courtroom Genius about Palkhivala's thing, I got to interview so many people who work with Palkhivala. So I would get the methods by which they work, and I would just make my notes and jot them down. So either one is to go by a direct mentor, secondly by observing, and by thirdly by asking. A junior should come to you and ask Mr. Pandian or sir, how did this person do? How was VP Raman like? How was MR and how was Goel Swaminathan like? You know, so I would just keep learning from them. Yeah. It has to be a self-taught process. In fact, the first day I entered the bar, my senior Mr. Natarajan told me, Kanna, nobody will teach you anything. Nobody has time. You have to learn on your own. And you have learned nothing in law college. You have to start learning afresh. So nobody will teach you. You learn on your own. And in fact, I'll tell the audience one thing I'll never forget, which my senior Natarajan told me once. He said, look, I don't care whether you become a cobbler or a barber. Just make sure you're the best barber and the best cobbler in town.
So my second question.
See, it's never too late. At my age, I'm already planning for the next 5 years. I'm already planning how am I going to tackle e-commerce? How am I going to tackle digital? So whether you're 20 or 40, so suppose you're, let's say you're 50 now, hypothetically, or 45 or 50. You got another 30 years of practice to go. 30 years is what a person normally works in life. So next 30 years, I sit and visualize what is going to be the new society like. In a digital world, what will be the role of a lawyer? How are the courts going to function? How are the things? Like I said, example, we don't have any more zamindari laws and that all the litigation is gone. Then in your own thing, you look what are the new tribunals coming? Am I going to work in those tribunals? So it's even at 50, you're still young. You still got 30 years to go. So I what I typically do is I prefer to keep a 5-year horizon, like 2025, where do I want to be? What books I want to write? And then break it down to 1 year, 90 days, and so on. So even now you can plan, think about 2023. Where do you want to be in 2023? Should be able to articulate it. I want to be at this place, X to Y by when? So, I mean, you're young. I mean, you got the same potential as a 25-year-old junior. And at my age, 60 plus, same thing.
Thank you, sir.
Raja, sir, if you want to supplement. Sir.
Yeah. Arvind, thanks once again for a very enriching experience in listening to you.
Thanks for joining.
You've always profited from association.
Then,
My question is a little hypothetical. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Please go ahead.
So my question is this. Let's assume, hypothetically a situation where the law minister tomorrow invites you for tea and says, Mr. Dattar, you've had 40 years of rich experience. Now tell me 3 reforms that we should do to improve the system. Now, what would you say would be those 3 reforms?
See, I'm very clear. First, I will improve the law college system. I'll first start with legal education. Make sure that shut down those non-operational colleges. Make sure that the person who passes out law really knows the subject. Start with a strong bar exam. So one level is to the legal education, because son or nephew who passes out in 2020, your son who passes out in 2020, he's going to be the judge in 2050, 2060. I'm going to start preparing right now. That's the first thing. Secondly, I think that there should be a very, very clear vision of what our system is, what will be for courts, what will be for tribunals. And what I find is, in Sanskrit, there's a word Arambashur. We start very well, but we don't follow up. We have great plans of tribunals. You're the national authority on consumer law. You know what's happened to consumer courts. So I will tell the court that, look, if you're having a court in a tribunal system, have a 5-year roadmap and please implement it. That is the second point I will make. And the third is, as far as the way in which the judges are selected, I'd rather have a complete a mixture of collegium plus this, where a proper person selected, not just senior person. So law college level, practice court system level, and the people manning the judges. Like, I would start a tribunal service. I would do that, yes. But I think legal education is the most important.
Thank you. In fact, I would like to inform you that I filed a public interest litigation to say that you can't have these open book examination for All India Bar exams. So this All India Bar, you have to have some sort of an entry barrier into the profession. I'm saying you can have any number of law colleges. If somebody wants to learn law, it's all very fine. But if somebody wants to get into the profession, there are standards which he has to satisfy. And this open book examination is making a mockery of it. I filed a PIL in Madras High Court. Let's see whether because what you're saying is very important. That we need to be very clear about who is coming into the profession. Thank you.
And I think what you're telling me is like the US model, where you can have any number of law colleges.
Yes. But
thank you very much, Raja sir and Arvind Pandian sir, for supplementing on this session today. Thank you very much, sir. Datta sir, Mr. Ramesh, I'm going to unmute. He's been wanting to supplement as well. Mr. T. Ramesh.
Prithvi, Sahas, audio is muted. Unmute his audio also.
Okay, but...
SAS video audio
yes.
Not unmuting. So good evening, sir.
I think Prithvi is saying enough now.
No, not at all, sir. Sir, the session.
Joking.
Good evening, sir.
Yes. No, please go. Yeah, Ramesh.
very enriching. Sir, the one aspect which I want to point out to you is that you will not talk about yourself. That even after reaching the pinnacle and the legendary, you are recognized as a legend in tax laws and other laws in Supreme Court. Still, nothing has gone into your head. So simple. Even when you are on your legs, whenever we want to put forth the point or tell something which we have not believed you properly, you never hesitated to tell that one. That simple nature, simplicity, even after reaching the pinnacle, has to be the mantra for the youngsters. Having said that, they are far ahead of our generation in terms of their knowledge and other aspects. The point should be put before them is good advice. What would be the good advice? How to emulate you, or nothing should go into their head even after seeing the success in the short term. That is what my thing.
I think youngsters are very bright. See, it's a matter of temperament. So some people get angry, some people don't get angry, some people are humble. It's a usual personal temperament. I don't know. I don't deliberately try to be humble. I don't think humility by itself is a virtue. But I personally feel that you can be happy, you can be proud, but in a quiet way. You don't have to show off and all that. The reason why I really feel I'm always a student. When I write a book, I realize that how little I know. You know, and the more you write, you realize there's so much more to know. So that is really a humbling experience. Like, you know, when I'm writing a book or something, you know, I'm just doing something on terrorist law and 4G judgment of the Supreme Court. There's so much more to learn on terrorism, constitutional law, public law. So that brings a sense of humility that, look, you have miles to go. Even at your age, there's much, 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 much more to achieve and to read and to attain.
Thanks.
Thanks, Babu.
Quickly, I would unmute Mr. Vasanta Kumar, sir. And after that, we will take it for the formal vote of thanks. Mr. Vasant Kumar, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Hello, Vasant. How are you?
Fine, sir. Fine, sir. Very good. Enlightening lecture. It's very, very happy to hear you, sir.
Thank you, sir. I have
two questions.
Yes.
Number one, how a tax lawyer has transferred from the constitutional era? Number two, sir, what made you to write a letter to H.M. Sirvai taking his permission to write the student section of the committee?
Well, two things. I'll answer the first question. Yes. I had, right from the beginning, I had said that I'll write a book on taxation, especially. You see, because I realized that only on constitutional law I can't survive, because just doing PILs and public law matters, you can't select. For example, take the tribunal matter, you know, the Madras Bar Association matter. How many days? It's all pro bono, so you can't survive on that. Even the Aadhaar matter or the privacy matter, all these are pro bono matters. You can't survive on that. So my strategy was to have one field of specialization, which is the bread and butter. And then you can, and I always loved constitutional law. And if I had to get to the Supreme Court level, I had to have a knowledge of constitutional law. So I had already decided that I'll write the book, and I'll write my constitution book by the time I'm 40. Unfortunately, we got hit by a virus. It took 4 more years. So we finally wrote, my book came in 2001. So I became a constitutional lawyer. I mean, I learned constitutional law as a deliberate thing, knowing tax plus knowing it. So I keep taxation as the bread and butter, and constitutional law is my own experience. Then the second question, what did you ask me? Second question?
What made you write the letter to Sirvai?
Yes. What happened was, I used to be constantly in the library, all that, and the law college was on strike. I found a student's edition of Palkhivala by H.P. Ranina, who was in Navy. He wrote a student's edition of Income Tax, well-written book at that time. And what happened was, in law college, I had purchased CY's constitutional law. I had purchased in law college itself. And to tell you a very interesting story, I had gone for the law college exam, and I'd kept both the volumes of Sirvai in my car. I forgot to put the window up. Somebody stole volume 2 of my Sirvai and didn't steal volume 1. He didn't steal this whole set. So I had Sirvai with me from, I was studying from law college days, Sirvai. Then I said that if Ranina can do a student's edition of Palkhivala, why can't I do a student's edition of Sirvai? That's how I wrote to Sirvai. And he wrote me a very long letter as to why it's not possible to put it in a single volume. Yes.
But the CMI commentary is a treatise in the subject, sir.
Yes. That's an amazing work of scholarship. Amazing work of scholarship. In fact,
that is very difficult to follow the commentaries of the book unless we have three volumes that simultaneously to read.
No, you can understand. That's what like Ramesh said, no, about humility. When you read people like Sirwai, then you realize how much more you have to travel.
Yes. Thank you, Ramesh, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. All the best to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Can I go ahead?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Arvind, two quick matters. One is you have not shared the secret of where you started writing and how you started writing your book on Constitution. It is certainly so. Constitution.
Uh-huh.
Where you started, etc. How you started and where you started writing the book.
Yeah.
That's one. The second thing is you should talk a little about the time management, how you schedule your calls, etc.
No. Ravi, sir, I'm sorry, sir. Ravi, sir, but we are not able to see you, sir.
Yeah.
Now you can see me.
I
don't tell you my
team.
Yes, sir.
How I wrote the... See, I had already decided to write the book on the Constitution. And at that time, I was working with some matters with Harish Salve. So we first decided to write the book together. And unfortunately, his mother fell ill. Whatever reason, he could not... Then I took up the book myself and I continued to write. And I remember I'd written a lot of pages I'd written out. And the Chernobyl virus, if you remember, it was in 1999, it hit many software systems. I lost the thing and my book took a setback. So to answer Ravi's question, I decided to write the Constitution. First, it's going to be a joint book with Harish. I mentioned it, it's in my first preface, it's there. Then I wrote it 2001, second edition 2007. And now I'm quite ashamed that no edition has come for 14 years. And hopefully this August to September, the next edition should come. That's how I wrote Constitution. As far as time management is concerned, I didn't want to bore the audience with time management, but I think that's the key for all of us. And I tell all of us that, see, we don't have plant and machinery. We don't have any other capital asset. Our only asset is time. And how much we utilize time is what it is. And as someone said, you don't waste time, you only waste yourself. That's what somebody said. And so I have been studying time management a lot. I still find that I'm quite inefficient personally. Have a lot areas to improve upon. But that's one area which has fascinated me. And I feel that unless you manage time, you can't do anything in life. That's my personal view. And basically what they say time management is an oxymoron. You can't manage time. Time just goes on. 60 seconds will go on, whatever you do. You can only manage yourself in relation to time. So that's what is fascinating to me. You know? Time blocking, deep work, scheduling, prioritizing, all these things I gave you are fascinating areas for me, and I keep reading them all the time. Yeah. In fact, my wife keeps wondering how many times I would read the same thing again and again. But I just keep studying them. I keep watching YouTube videos on goal setting. For example, David Allen, fantastic book on getting things done, GTD. So there are various schools. Yes. In fact, I did speak at Ravi's invitation at some seminar on time management also. Thanks, Ravi, for attending. Thanks.
No, but you're not telling them that you started writing your Constitution book in the upper tire of a Grand Trunk Express.
No. That's not the Constitution book. That is my excise book.
Okay. Some book.
No, my central excise book. I was going to Delhi for a Grand Lodge meeting and my father was flying to Delhi. I couldn't afford air, so I was traveling by train. And on GT, I started writing in November 86. I started writing on the GT upper berth. Yeah. And I should always take the upper berth so that nobody keeps disturbing. In the train, you see everybody start chatting. What are you doing? What's your family? How much money you're earning? Especially in second class, everybody keeps asking all person. I used to always go on to the topmost berth. And the second reason is topmost berth, that railway light is very small, you see. So if you take the upper berth, you can work at night also with that light nearer you. That's how I started writing the book.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, I'm sure that you wouldn't have faced so many other questions in your other academic
pleasure,
sessions.
Pleasure.
Yes. Thank you very much, sir. So one last question, which one of our members wanted me to ask, and it is what is the secret behind your fitness and for you ever looking young, sir?
Oh, no, I'm not fit at all. In fact, I've got this, one of my weak thing. I've got zero control over my food. I eat too many sweets. I like too many soft drinks. It's just, I think, fitness is no, this is dark hair is genetic. There is nothing, no fitness. I'm not a great fitness person. And I've been blessed with good health, but I'm not at all. I wish I had more discipline on the food and the exercise part. But honestly, I do try to, when I'm in, I stay in hotels most of the time. So I do use the gym. I try to exercise 3-4 times a week. That I do. But I'm not very much deep into fitness as much as I should be. Yeah. But I do at least walk a few days a week, exercise a few days a week, even now do some light weights and so on. That I do. Yeah. But I wish I was more disciplined in diet.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, now I apologize to all the participants because I have been flooded with questions, but I couldn't take all the questions. So sincerely, sir, I thank you once again. But to tell thanks, we have Mr. Jayakumar, sir, who in his own words can express our gratitude to you, sir. So
thank the audience for attending.
I'll unmute you. Jayakumar, sir.
Yes, thank you, Prithvi.
Ruchi, thanks for conducting the program.
Sinir, I've always heard the word abracadabra. I just saw it. For the past 90 minutes, I saw what is it. And that too, when what is the actually a magical wand with a magician. We had the, I would say, we made history because we crossed 400 audience today. Spellbound. Oh. We had crossed 400, sir. And all of them spellbound by the magician with one word, abracadabra. In fact, I never wanted to talk because, as Gandhi said, you have to speak only if you can add value to the silence. And after this session by you, and as well as by the other, audience query, I thought that I should not speak. But these two, Krishnananda and Ramesh, initiated that inside me that I have to share these anecdotes to the juniors with my personal experience with you. Anyway, very short, 2 minutes. To the juniors I will address because I know that you will be very modest to listen to this. Once, when we went to Kerala High Court, similar experience of Krishnananda, there was the opposite side. It was not the judge, it was the opposite side who was pulling senior and was completely tensed. And all my senses were, erupted. And you told me, keep calm. And you also said two things I wanted to share with these people. One is that you said, in a court, you are not important, I am not important. But the case is very important. And if we are going to be emotional, then the first casualty is the case. And when I came out, I said, you're such a senior and he's talking like this. Then you said, I don't know whether you remember that you picked an anonymous quote and told me, once the game is over, both the king and the pawn go to the same box. And you also said, I have never seen chess in that way. And after that, I couldn't see chess anything more than that. Once the game is over, both the king and the pawn go to the same box. Sir, I will only finish it with...
tell the audience one thing which my senior Natarajan told me, which... His senior, Mr. Mohan Kumar, told him, he said that, he said, when you get angry with a judge, he said, just remember one thing, for you, it is your bread and butter, for your client, it's his life.
Wonderful, yes.
It's his life. So he's put your life in your hands. So there's no point getting upset and getting annoyed. That's what I learned from my senior.
I remember that. So finally, coming to Ramesh, in fact, he was talking about your humility. I only got reminded because these are all not prepared. It's just coming out because I thought that I should not speak. After Ramesh said, I just think of one, I remember of Leo Tolstoy saying, a man is a fraction in which the numerator is what he thinks of himself and the denominator is what he is, or other way. And the more and more what he thinks of himself, the denominator expands, he becomes very small. I have to tell you, sir, in my life, I have seen a person with the greatest fraction, with the highest amount of fraction means it is you.
Thank you.
I have to sum up with this and thank you for coming and educating. I am getting flooded. My 256 GB is over. My iPhone is full. I'm getting so many thanks from all the juniors particularly. And thanks a lot.
Very frankly, when I first started this, I never knew that people will like it. I said, I don't know what. I said, let me just share my own thoughts because they should not feel I'm just boasting or something like that. So I tried my best to make it interesting for everybody. Thank you so much for the wonderful response.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
From in fact, I would just want to state, sir, and that just, today we have touched 400 marks, sir. So this was the... Yeah.
It's a record.
For, yes, as you said, you told me, you know, that item 7 will be the first item. That June 1st should be the new beginning for all of us.
Exactly. In fact, we made that, if you all see that PowerPoint, which will be shared with you, the last slide on the random thought, senior would have put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 is tomorrow is a great day, something like that, a fresh start. So that after 6, the serial number 1 will be placed.
Yes,
1, 2, 3, 4, 6, and then 1 will be there. So for all of us, he has given a wonderful start. So with... such a word of thanks, I just conclude the session, sir. Handing over the mic to Prithvi. Thank you, Prithvi.
Thank you. Thank you very much once again, Jay Kumar, sir, for those words. And thank you, Dattar, sir, for this wonderful session. This was really one of the very, very productive sessions. I thank all the participants who have joined from the entire country today. Thanks for taking out the time on a Monday evening to listening to the great Dattar sir itself. In fact, our password for today also has been specially kept as Dattar Talks. It was a suggestion by the committee members itself. So, and this shows the charisma, sir, by which all of us follow you, sir. So, thank you.
Thank you so much. Wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Ali.
Yes.
Thank
sir.
You. Yes.
So thank you all the participants for joining us. We will be uploading this in our YouTube channel. The link has already been shared. You can always catch up with this program on our YouTube channel. Tomorrow we will be having one more session. The details of it will be shared soon. So now, with the permission of Srinivas sir, can I close this session, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I'm ending the session now.